To talk to you about how can you create a good MVP. I think it in Creative Valley it's a pretty big subject for you as a startup. MVP is a minimum viable product. I think you all know what it is, but I prefer to repeat it. Is anyone everyone has been able to look the videos of a Y Combinator which has been sent normally? Just to be sure, if I need to precise some aspects.
Maybe you can, yeah, on the chat.
Yeah, in the chat directly. Okay, great. Perfect. So normally it will be just some kind of reminder, but I added some information which is complementary, I hope, with the YC videos. So let's go. Just for the quick start, who am I? I'm Clément Barberousse. I'm the co-founder of EvoDev. It's a company which has been founded at the end of 2019. We are actually building MVP for entrepreneurs and companies, and all of it without code and with the tools which is Bubble. And we are seven. No, we are now we are nine peoples. We will be 10 in a few weeks, and we launched approximately 15 projects for now. Not all with Bubble, for the little history. Some part was with other tools at the beginning, but now we are working only with Bubble. Just for the quick introduction, let's jump on the main subject. So first, I propose you to just have a little look on the. What is the entrepreneur journey in the big pictures of the entrepreneur journey? First, you think you found a problem. It's the first part normally. You try to in the second part you try to understand which is this problem as better as you can. In the second part, you build and create and offer a solution to this problem to a market. And third part, if everyone goes well, you scale and you change the world. This is the success story of an entrepreneur journey. Of course, with a lot of different aspects in the real life, but it's a good start. I wanted to show you some important milestones. I think it's always important to have a precise idea of what is the journey of what is the milestone you have at the beginning of a project. I don't think is absolutely true, and it's definitely not absolutely true what I show you right now. But in many time it can help you to understand where you are actually and what you need to achieve, what you still need to achieve. So the first part, the days you see 3 days, 2 days, 3 days, 5 days, etc., is not really the time. It depends on your idea, your problem, etc., your market, etc., etc. But in many cases, I think you can try to fit those days, 3 days for the first interviews to understand the problem on the market. I think it's a pretty it's not a lot, but it can be pretty interesting. You can have a lot of information with 3 full days of interview. You can learn a lot. After that, you will define. We will do it just after. But after that, you want to define the user journey and the user stories of your product. Does anyone do you all know what is the user journey and the user stories? Okay, everyone know what it is? Okay, great. Very great, okay. Now, user journey is like, I will explain quickly. It's really simple, in fact. To explain, user journey is the journey, is the different step your user will get through with your service or your product or etc. It doesn't matter what. Is the different step. You have to see it like a some step in the process, and the user stories is the different action and different functionalities of your product in each of those steps of the user journey. Okay, you will see. We will do it in Whimsical just after, but this is to give you a pretty interesting big pictures of what my user will get through and what he will be able to do in my product or with my services or anything else. Is it a bit more clear? That's okay. Great. Great. Cool. So after that, you can start to create your prototype. Just to be precise, difference between prototype and MVP, I don't think is an official definition. It's more or less my definition of the subject, but I think it can help you a lot to understand more precisely what is the difference between two of these things. The prototype is something which is you can use as a user, but use it alone. Without any help of someone of the customer services of a product will be difficult normally. Okay, it's a product which not work by himself. It's a pretty manual product. An MVP is like your final product, but the first the V0, really the first version of this final product. But normally an MVP, it's a product you can send to your user, and they will be able to use it by themselves. If they are not, it's because you need to improve your MVP. But normally the definition of MVP is a product which live by himself and you can improve. So first part, you will create the prototype. Prototype basically many times is like a Figma or Adobe XD, something like that, like a maquette. I don't know, wireframe, I think is the word in English, which you can click on it to navigate in it. It's a pretty good example of prototype. So you will create your prototype, something like 2 or 3 days, not many more is needed. And just after that, after 3 days, you will start to show your prototype to some user and get some change because. You will have some feedback and it will require some modification. So you show your prototype, and when this prototype is good, people when they see it, understand your product, understand where they have to click or anything else, understand what is useful for this product. You can start to build your MVP. It's something a bit more difficult. You will need. It depends, of course, of your product, but it can take something like 3, 4, 5, 10 days. 10 days. Try to don't overcome these 10 days because after that is a bit too much for an MVP. You really want to get it simple and build it fast is the main objective of an MVP. The main value of the MVP is to be launchable fast. So don't spend 2 months on it. It's a mistake, I think. When you spend your 10 days approximately, and maybe less, and it's a good thing, you can launch your product. And after that, you have only two main things, is to sell your product and improve it by just discussion and improvement of your MVP. It's just a discussion and tech part, two things together. And sales, and all your time will be dedicated to those three things normally. If you've done some mistakes by defining your proposition value or your problematics at the beginning, you have to start at the step to re-understand at the interview step to re-understand which are the problem, who is my persona, which are my buyer, which people will need my product or my services. So be careful to really be really careful on this step, the interview one. You really have to be open-minded and open-minded to the you might have to kill your product at this stage. It can be really it can it might looks really soon to kill a project, but many time a project can be you know. If your project has to be killed or not at this stage if you do it really well. Of course, it's a really, really difficult thing to do that efficient interview. Is really a difficult thing. Sometime this milestone will not be like that because you can avoid products, and it's a good thing. A lot of business can be launched without a product. Sometimes your value is more in the services or something like that, and not definitely on the product you build. So it's a good thing because it will be you will know faster if you've done a mistakes at the interview stage. So it's a good news. You will lose less time. So the interview sometimes is a bit longer because it's more difficult in services type to have interview, etc. It's generally more difficult. You have a lot of B2B services are in that type of milestone way. So you have the interview. After that, you define the user journey and user story. Nothing changed on this part. But the second part change, the third part, sorry, change. You will start to sales directly after that and solve the problem manually. At the beginning, you just want to solve the problem manually. It will take a lot of time, and you will definitely not have any money benefits on it. But it's fine. Just the first part, you want to solve the problem manually, and after that, you will build your prototype. You take the classic way. You will build your product. So, classic milestone of product: build your prototype, show your prototype, improve it, build your MVP, and start the iteration way. Do you have any question on those milestone and or recommendation, or maybe something you are not agree with? It can be pretty interesting. Okay. Is there anyone who is at the improve and the iteration stage, already done the MVP extra? Okay, everyone or before, and who is in the first version of Milestone, the with product one, and you can put a one, for example, and the one who are on the second part of Milestone, if you can avoid product, you can type two. Just to have an idea of who definitely needs a product and who can maybe avoid it. Okay, first one, two, okay. One, okay, a lot of product. You like product, guys. Okay, great. Okay, so great. Okay, product. I think it will be interesting. It's pretty interesting because we will see it in more details at the next stage when we will do the workshop of how to create your user story and user journey. You will see sometime we can do manually things. Sometime we are pretty convinced that we need a product absolutely because without product our offer has no value. And many time is not really the case. But sometime it is. So it will be interesting to see. After. So thanks. The most important things you have to get is kill every little tiny features which are not absolutely vital. It's really something really difficult. We all love our features when we launch our product. We are absolutely certain that if we remove this 12 features, the product has no value. And if it's the case, it's many times a pretty bad news because if your product can be don't have enough value to be interesting for your customer with only three, four, or five features, you many times you have three ways. You think this, but it's not the truth. This is the good news. Less good news is you have a pretty hard competition on your market. and the worst news is your product is not something your customer will want. You really have to think twice you want implement features, be really sure about how much vital this feature it is. And the one of the most important thing of that is you will do few things on the beginning, but do it well. Perfect example of a user journey and user story. It's a project that I want to launch. It's a side project I have, personal side project I have, that I might will launch something like around April, something like that. I'm just thinking of it. Just to explain you the problem, I use a lot of to-do app, and I'm not really. I don't love my to-do apps. They are good, but not really fit my needs, I think. And I wanted to try to create something a bit different. I start to talk with some user, etc. And I had something like that. Actually, for people, it's difficult to. Organize a time, the time you want to set on the daily, on the to-do. And for that, you have three main parts, which I described. This is the user journey. You see, you have three columns. The first step of the user journey is plan your day as a user. The second step is the to-do, plan your to-do list and execute your to-do list. And the third and last one is analyze the task you've achieved. So this is the three steps of my user. Normally, each time they arrive in analyze, they will go back to the plan your day, and it's a rip. This is why it's something like a product on that type of things. And after that, you have every blue card you have under it is a user stories. Normally, a user story is not like that. Is as a user, I want to do na na etc. I didn't do it like that because, okay, it's good, it's a methodology, but the result is the same, honestly. So is every little things the user will be able to do. Normally, if you don't have a card which says the user, see, I have a card is edit a task. If I remove edit a task, people can create a task, add a task, but they never will be able to edit a task. If it's not in that, if it's not in the blue card, it will not be able to do. It's not something you will be able to do in the application. You will see many time on the. I love this exercise because many time when you start to do it. You have 50 cards, and you understand you will have some big problem because something like that is easy to do with an MVP, but not really easy. If you have 50 cards, it's nearly not impossible, but it's really, really difficult. So in the first version, you really want to create cards, and every time you can remove a card, remove it really. I will show you after all the ID I have for the project. I have so many much more cards than that. Actually, if you read the blue card, this is not an awesome product. When you read it, it create a task. You can put it in to do. You can close it, and you can have some data. It's not awesome, but it's fine. I have. We will have many other features later. Just this is the first version, the first ID, the first things, and we will start to build after a more deep product. You have two really interesting things to do this. Whimsical, is a tool that I love because it's really easy to use and simple. And Miro, which you probably already know. So as you prefer, I recommend you to use Whimsical because you will definitely can be you will be able to do really the same structure. So as you prefer, but I recommend you Whimsical. I think we will split in room. It will be better.
Is it the moment to split room? Do you want to do it now?
Yeah, we can split room. Okay. Obviously, maybe just if someone have question about the exercise, if you don't really understand what you need to achieve, don't hesitate. I can be more precise. But the objective is we will take something like 20, 25 minutes just to define your user journey and your user stories. Again, be really careful about the user story you pick. Just pick the vitals one. Always remember this vitals things.
Okay. And Clément, do they have to go on Whimsical?
Yeah, if they can, I think it will be better. If they really love and prefer Miro, I don't want to be too hard. But yeah, I recommend the Whimsical. I think it will be easier.
Okay.
And I will show you quickly just which one you have to create, just to be sure. Too many Google accounts. it's a mess. it's on this. No, this is the user journey at EvoDev. Interesting, but not the subject. Here, you have to create this one, the sticky notes. Okay. Don't take flowchart, don't take docs, don't take wireframe, don't take mind map. Take the sticky notes, the green one. And when you will create it, it's open something like that. And after it's really, really simple, you will have just to use two things. This one is the stack, is as you see, as you can see, it's just to put your user journey. Really easy. You can duplicate and put it on it. Really easy. And after that, when you want to ask some user stories, so the blue card, it's just the plus button and it has the blue card. Simple as that. You just need to do that. I recommend you just to take a little, just put a little text field on the top and just write the problematic you want to solve. It's really help to, it's like a reminder, you know, when you build your user journey and user stories, is it my user stories really solving the things on the top? It helps you to remind what you want to achieve. So just write your problematic on the top, as I did here. Organize your daily to-do list, etc. And after you can build the table. It's fine for everyone.
I have a question.
Yeah, of course. Hi, Celia.
Hi. Do we have to do it on the to-do list example?
You can do it with your own project. To-do list example is an example I proposed to you with one of my project, okay. Just to show you actual how it's look. But you no do it with your project.
Okay, so we choose one project of someone in the team and then we do the work on this one.
Or just you have a personal project at Creative Valley, no?
Yeah, I do have my project, but I thought we were working in teams. Okay.
No. The team, the team rooms would just be to discuss about how you do it, etc. But work on your own project. It's your own
okay.
map.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So if you're all ready, I'm going to split the room. So either you use Whimsical. I told you in my email to create an account. But if you didn't, I think you have time because Clément is going to go into the different rooms. So I think you will have time to create an account if you didn't. And I will see you in the different room. I will go around the rooms too. See you. Hello, hello.
Hello.
So were you all able to create an account? Ah, je crois qu'on a encore une room de French speaker. On a de la chance.
Ouais. C'est ce que j'étais en train de me dire, si on peut parler français.
Il y a du monde à cette meuf?
Un petit peu. Je ne sais pas où ils sont tous. Peut-être pas de notre côté, non. J'ai vu Adrien passer chercher des colocataires.
D'accord. Okay,
oui, c'est bon. Pour ma part, c'est bon pour Whimsical.
Attends, ok, super. De mettre, comme je suis sûre. Et du coup, faire les sticky notes comme il l'a montré. Et je pense qu'en fait, il va passer dans les trois. Il va passer dans les trois rooms et.
Ce que je n'ai pas compris, c'est en fait comment on appliquait son exemple à notre sujet, en fait, pour être très clair.
Ouais, je pense qu'il va être, il va vous expliquer tout ça. Parce que normalement,
okay. Parce que du coup, j'ai bien compris que l'outil nous permettait en fait finalement de faire un prototype de notre besoin et de savoir comment y répondre, mais je n'ai pas réussi à comprendre comment on appliquait sa méthode.
Mais ok, garde ta question en tête. Je vais voir où il en est avec l'autre groupe, je reviens.
D'accord.
To me, your project to help me to understand your problematic and your project, etc. Always start by the problematic you want to solve. It's really counterintuitive to do this. I know that, but don't hesitate to do it. Always start. I want to solve this problem for this kind of people, and my solution is this one. You always start by my solution is, and it can be a pretty obvious for you to make the connection between your solution and the problem you want to solve. But for someone, for someone who listened it for the first time, he has to wait the entire proposition value, the description of your entire proposition value, to start to try to make the link between your proposition value, maybe your potential user, which target you target, which people you target, and on the top of that, which problem will guess the problem you want to solve, and it's definitely the main and the most important thing. So always start to describe it by the problematic. So I go back on it, presentation mode. So okay, this part, okay. So at the end, normally you have something like that. For example, on this example, I think the analyze part is maybe too much. I think just plan your day and to do might be enough. For example, if I count, I will have something like seven features. I will do it. I can kill the three on the right, maybe, because okay, it's something interesting, but I'm not sure it's vital. As we said.
I don't know if you're sharing your screen right now, but we don't see anything.
Yeah. Okay, I do it again. Not again. I didn't. Sorry, my bad. It should be better. It's okay. Yeah, fine. Perfect. So I can keep the eight task here. I think it's vital. Without it, you nearly can do nothing in the MVP. But this part analyze can be something a little maybe kill it, or something really easier, like not all those type of chart, but I can maybe just send an email, a weekly email, to recap the performance and the analyze of the people, which I will do with my hands manually. Because at the beginning on the MVP, you will have something like 20 and 100 user, it's a pretty good start when you have that, so it's fine. You don't want to have too much people because you want to talk to each user and to have really a personal relation with your user at the MVP stage. So you really have to think, my first user on the MVP will not be your friend, but maybe you will have really a close relation with them, talk with them as more as you can. So it can be really possible to me to just do manually all the analyze and send them with email something really simple. It will be done the job. I will skip the prototype part to explain you it. It's the first prototype start to do for this project. Just do it with the system UI. I put you just some system some cool you have UI wizard. You have Figma, you have Adobe XD, you have something like Balsamic Mockup also, which is pretty good. So first time, just do the UX, so black and white part only, like you have here. And after that only, you can do maybe if you want, but it's not all. You have some MVP builder create the design exactly as you want. So sometimes it's interesting to do in Figma, for example, a pixel perfect, a beautiful UI and UX screen. But sometimes it's not necessary because you will not be able to achieve it with your MVP tools. Some websites which are pretty cool to inspiration for your design is Dribbble, Behance, Pinterest. There is ton of other, but those three are the main and most interesting, I think. If you are not really friendly with the design, don't hesitate to really copy as most as you can a design. I think it's really important to do it because if not, it will be difficult to have a consistent design. On this part, you can see I just put you a little disclaimer. Be really careful about it. If you don't know the MVP tools you will use to build your MVP, be careful because many times you will prototype something you will not be able to build really in your MVP. It can be a pretty big problem because you will start to interact with your user, your future user, with the prototype by showing them your prototype and show them this is how the platform will look like, et cetera, et cetera. They will tell you, okay, great, after some exchange and modification, now it's good, we like it, we want to use it for real. And you will arrive at the step, the for real step, and the reality is you can't do it as you plan. So really be careful. If you don't know, maybe sometime I think it can be interesting to just have a little quick view of the MVP tools you might will use, and when you have done a little overview of it, go and work on your prototype. It's maybe interesting to do a little check before that. I had a little let's build part for the MVP. I'm not sure we will have the time, so I think I will jump on the next part, and if we have some time and we can spend on it, I will show you quickly. I don't think it's a really interesting part because I just wanted to show you on Glide how much you can build rapidly a decent MVP, a first MVP version. But I think you already know this. There is ton of platform now which learn and help you to use those kind of tools. 1 year ago, it was most difficult, but now you have plenty of content on internet, I think. So you maybe already know how to use it. So if it's really necessary, I will come back on this part just after. I recommend you some tools again for the MVP. You have Bubble, which is really difficult to manage, but when you manage it, is really cool because you can build everything you want. But I don't recommend you to start by Bubble. The good things many times is to have UMSO, Glide, Airtable, Timeform, Outgrow. All those are really good to start just a first version, a first MVP. And after that, when you have limitation on your development features, etc., it's really interesting to have a look on Bubble because it's actually the most powerful builder on the market on no-code. And so it can be really interesting to don't be limited by the features you can build. But after that, when you have your MVP, it's good, but it's only the beginning of the journey. It's a pretty good achievement to arrive at this step of MVP, but it's really the first step. So you really want to arrive at this MVP launch stage faster as you can. It's really important. And after that, you start the iterate part, maybe the most important and the most cool part, is you will want, you only have declarative data when you are at the launch MVP stage. You only have interview with declarative data, people that says to you, I want that, I have this problem, I think it can be good to do this to solve my problem, etc., etc. At the moment, you want action data. You don't want people who tell you, I will need maybe in a world these features to solve my problem. You want people who click on a button and actually solve their problem through the action. And this is so much better proof than declarative data. The action data is the only real proof. As the American says, only a credit card payment with credit card is the best proof of a product market fit you can have. And I think it's a really true. So you will have to set up your data and define your key metrics. Be really careful about it because it seems, it looks like it's simple, but it's really difficult to just define which are the correct metrics to measure and what can we do with those measurements. What actions can we take? For example, it's really difficult because there is no big rules for it. It's always depend on your business, on your market, on many things, on your stack, on your technical stack. It depends on many things. I just give you a short and little example with the product I speech you just before on the task system. I have three key metrics for now, which I think are really important. First, does my value proposition is interesting? Is it something when I say to people, hello, you want to be able to do your to-do list on time? We have a tools for that. Is it something which is important for people? How measure it is pretty simple. You just want to know your conversion rate, how much people come on your website, how much people are registered on your website. You might can add something like the number of click on an ad, for example. It's a pretty good and interesting value proposition test. You can just put your value proposition on the ads and send it to people and see if it's interesting or not. So this is first interesting part. Possible action on top of it. You can show video of the product if you want on the landing page, for example, just to activate a little bit more the interest for the proposition, to explain better your proposition. Explain the key benefits of a good task manager, for example. So maybe people have this problem, but they don't understand how much is important to solve it. So just try to show them and have some proof with testimonials. If you have satisfied clients, don't hesitate to make them to create testimonials with them. It will sometimes help you, your client, to trust your proposition. After that, you have all my user returning on my app and do I stay in their mind? This is really important. This is maybe the most important things for a product, and not only for a product, for a service. I think it's also important. It's when you have someone which is interested by your proposition value, you are after the first step. Does your product really solve this problem? So normally you have someone which has a problem you identify. It's a pretty good news because you know the good problem. But the question is, are you able to solve it? And this is approximately the final step. If you can't solve a problem, you have no value. So this is really important to solve the problem. And when you have a problem which has a recurrency, it's really important to know how much you solve it every day and on how many times you solve it. So possible action, improve the onboarding. Maybe people just churn after 2 or 3 days because they just don't understand your product. Many times it will be on day one. If people don't understand your product in 10 minutes, many times they will drop. So improve the onboarding can really help on these metrics. Test a simpler UI, maybe add important features that they require, that people want, and maybe it will help to hit a better score on day 30, for example. Do some ads targeting on user with as a churn your product. Maybe they just leave your product and they don't remind the name of your app, this awesome app that they loved, but they don't remember the name. If you put an ad and they remember your name, they will go back on your apps and improve your day one, day seven, day 30 retention. So maybe it's just something simple as that. So it's some possible action you can try. And how intensive is the usage of the app? It's a pretty something. How can I say that? It really depends on your application, product, and problematic, etc. So in my use case, it will be how many tasks user create every day. It's a pretty good indicator of how much intensively they use the product. And sometimes I can use it, I can improve this amount by just set up a maximum amount of time to do a task. For example, if I say to you, you can't put a task in my to-do list app, which is more than 60 minutes, for example, it can be a pretty good booster for just improve your number of tasks if you had some task which were something like 3 hours or etc. So it can be managed with it or improve the rewards feedback when the task is achieved. More you like achieve a task, more you will create tasks to achieve task and have this good feeling of yes, I achieve a task. It can be a good booster for this metrics also. Just track. Don't track too many metrics. Always have a question, measure it with metrics, and take some actions. Anticipate some actions you can do to leverage those metrics. And always remember to add the metrics only when you will track, and more than that, not track, but when you have a good usage of the metrics. It had no sense to add a new tracker, new metrics tracking, if you already don't do some actions with your previous tracking. Okay, so you can delete if you want some metrics, but act it like that. Say, okay, this metric is deleted, we stop using it, and we replace it by a new one. You can do that, but don't add a new metrics if you already don't use your three first metrics. It has no sense. Some bench of tools for analytics and analytics, global analytics. It can be action data, like declarative data, the two of those. You have the really classical Google Analytics, Google Tag Manager, and Oja. I think you all know them. It's pretty good tools. Google Analytics, not really easy to use, but pretty interesting. June and Action Desk are really interesting to merge some different kind of data. For example, if you sales by a relate, just you have a more sales operation, like people to people for sales, and after that you have a funnel which is online. It's really interesting to cross your data between, for example, a pipe drive, sales pipe drive, and some metrics of your Google Analytics or etc. So it can be really interesting. June do that really good, and ActionDesk do that really good too. Two, if I don't mistake, ActionDesk I'm sure is French, but June, if I remember well, is also French. So Cocorico is great. And after that, you have three other which are really interesting. Crisp and Video Ask are pretty much the same things. It's really interaction with your user by chatting for Crisp and with video for Video Ask. And Scrib is a little bit different. Maybe Scrib and Video Ask are more in the same category, and Crisp is also is something a bit different. Crisp is really for the relationship. If someone has need help, you can help help them pretty fast. And Scrib and Video Ask is really to ask to your user, is my product good enough? What can I add to my product? What do you need? Etc. etc. Is really to have feedback, qualitative feedback from your user. So it's a really great tools. Two of them, Scrib and Crisp are French also. So good things. And I think that's all. If you have some question, we have some time. So don't hesitate to ask, and I hope it will help.
So no questions. Do not hesitate to activate your mic if you have some.
Pleasure, Alexandre.
Clément, I have quick question.
Pleasure.
So I started, I did my prototype on InVision, and then I did my MVP on, it's an app, so create React Native. My question is, for any iteration later on, I suppose I need to do coding. I can't do a no code plug on my app, right?
If you are on React Native, yes, you will have of course to develop. You want to say each iteration, we have to develop another part with coding, or just to connect the data.